I Family and friends, I welcome you into this gathering which is made sacred with the spirit of love and friendship you bring to this gathering. I've known Mo, as he was affectionately called, and been a family friend of the Rockliffes for almost 40 years. And I grew up beside this larger-than-life man as he towered over me as an 11-year-old boy. He loved baseball, was a great coach to his boys. He loved fishing. He had the best fishing boats on the block. He loved cars, and I swear to you to this date, I've never seen anybody keep their car so clean like the day he picked it up at the dealership. Every time Tyler said, "We're gonna pick you up," I had to check my shoes before I got into the car. He's also a great friend and peer and co-worker, working 30 plus years at Petro-Canada Refinery. But most of all, he was a husband and a father and loved his family. On behalf of William Henry Morris Rockliffe's family, I would like to say thank you so very much to all of you who have come today to be with them today. Beloved husband of Joe Rockliffe, loving father of sons Jason and Tyler, and daughter Cindy, and beloved grandfather to Halen Quinn, we are here to say farewell and to honor the life and memory of Mo. We honor Mo for his devotion to his family, his adventurous spirit, and strength and courage to stand up for what he believes. So we are gathered here today in grief and in sorrow, but we've also gathered to celebrate a life. We have come together to give thanks that we knew this vibrant person, to express our gratitude for the days and years we were able to share with him. We are here to remember and memorialize a good, caring life. By remembering the best of Mo, by recalling some of his finest qualities, by honoring his principles, values, and dreams which guided his life, we are gathered for all these things. Each of you comes with unique memories of Mo, for he was not the same person to any two people. And you each bring your own special memories of a man touched your lives with love and friendship in a myriad of ways. So I would like to begin with a prayer on behalf of Joe Rockliffe. This comes from Romans chapter 8, verse 38-39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love that is Christ Jesus our Lord. Our Lord, you are near us today as we remember the life of our loved ones. We honor their life, knowing that nothing in this world can separate any love from your love. We celebrate the memories of Mo Rockliffe and ask that you comfort our grieving hearts. Amen. Amen. So now if we could begin with Kelly Rockliffe, his daughter-in-law.
When you say Mo's name, you can't help but smile, as he truly was one of a kind. He was a strong-willed man who believed what he believed, thought what he thought, and he never wavered. Mo liked a good debate, and he would often call me, probably knowing I would take the opposite view. Sometimes I would see his point and think, okay, maybe. But come to think that Mo never thought about my points. He stuck by his word. But then it happened. One day, Mo called me, and I wish I could remember the story, but I think I went into shock. When Mo finished, I said, "Mo, you're not going to believe this. The world has stopped spinning." We finally agreed. I think it was a first, and he had a good chuckle. And then I read this quote the other day by Dr. Seuss, and I thought, yeah, this is Mo. It said, "Be who you are, say what you feel, because those who mind don't matter, and those who matter don't mind." He definitely spoke his mind, and he did not conform to the masses. He was a true individual. You always knew if you asked Mo something, he would give you an honest answer. You may not like the answer, but you knew it would be honest and truthful. He was strong-willed, maybe even a little stubborn, but underneath his tough exterior was a soft, kind-hearted man. All I had to do was mention Halen and Quinn, and tears of extreme happiness would fall immediately. "Halen and Quinn, your granddad loved you and was very proud of you both. When I called Mo the day I found out I was expecting twin boys, Mo was so full of emotion, he hung up on me." He did call me back later. He loved his visits and his phone calls from you both. And just this past weekend, we were coming back from a karate tournament. I said, "Hey, Halen, don't forget, we have to call Gran." "Oh, no, we can't do that anymore." We would always call Mo after every event to let him know how everyone did and send lots of pictures and videos so that he didn't miss out. Those moments will and have already been missed. Joe, Mo's love for you was fierce. He was proud to call you his wife, and I could see it when I came to visit. And right to the end, Mo wanted to love and protect you. He called Tyler numerous times as the end was nearing to ensure that you would always be taken care of. He was not leaving you without the absolute assurance that his beautiful wife is cared for with the best possible love and care. He truly loved you for you. And I remember going out for dinner with Joe, Mo, and Tyler. And Joe was talking to everyone at every table nearby. And Tyler was getting worried that Joe was interrupting people's dinner, especially the couple that was celebrating their wedding anniversary. But the patrons were like, no, Joe's great, they're not bothering me. But when I looked across the table, Mo was laughing so hard, he was shaking. He then told Tyler with great affection that, don't worry, it's okay, that's your mother, and that is what she does. He really loved you. Tyler, your dad thought the world of you. I know you are hurting right now, and will for a while, but your dad lived a wonderful, low life, and was so proud to call you his son. You were there for him whenever he needed. When he called, you went. So Mo, I hope you are at peace and are no longer in pain, because you are loved and will be greatly missed.
So I have to say, yes, he was always truthful and honest. As I said, I grew up with him, and for those of you who didn't know, Mo was a big baseball fan and was a coach to Tyler. And Tyler was a pretty good player. And he wanted me to play with, he said, Johnny, come play. I didn't play baseball, I played hockey. I said, are you sure? He goes, yeah, come play. My dad's gonna be the coach. He's gonna pick you. And I'm like, okay, all right, Tyler, okay. So I went for these tryouts and Mo was there. And after the tryouts, Mo went up to Tyler and he's like, you know, Tyler, he's not very good. He's not gonna help us.
I was like, what do you mean?
But Tyler was like, oh, Dad, I want him on my team. So sure enough, Mo did pick me. I think I went 0 for 49 that year. So it was terrific. But he was very honest and was truthful with everything he said. So now we're gonna call on Mike Mancini. Mike Mancini to say a few words.
So probably most of you don't know me.
What do you need?
Oh, there. Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I've been down in Texas with the other Mo in my life, Maureen. That this little story I want to say started about August 15th or so, 1975, where we visited right before. We were talking about getting married, maybe coming up to school here. And I was telling Mo, Uncle Mo, in the backyard, and he was sanding one of the kitchen chairs that I was just sitting on earlier. And I'm stumbling as a stupid little 19-year-old kid, thinking about getting married and gonna get married, and explaining that there was some complications to the whole thing about why we might be rushing, but you figure that out. Uncle Mo did not blink. He didn't stop sanding, and he just kept saying, okay, Mikey, always called me Mikey, one of the very, very few people to call me Mikey. And he said, Mikey, the sun's gonna come up tomorrow, one way or the other. What are you gonna do? We got married. So I'm here to say thank you, Uncle Mo, that, and for all 17,669 days since, that helped us move in the right direction.
Thank you for those kind words. Mo's daughter Cindy could not be here with us today, but wanted to say a few words, so she sent in a couple of words, and Kelly was gracious enough to come in and read those words as well.
So Cindy lives out west, and unfortunately she couldn't be here, and I know she's very sad about that. I talked to her this week, And I said, don't worry, because you were here when it mattered. When he was with us, you came. So unfortunately, she couldn't be here today, but she came when it meant most to Mo. So these are the few words that she wanted me to say. Dear Father, you were the best daddy a little girl could ever have. So much love and so many special memories made. You were my rock as I got older. You always had my back, and we recreated so many more special memories. You were always there for me and always will be. Forever in my heart, love always, Cindy, her husband Cam, and their daughter Kai.
Now, if we could have Sheila join us to share a few memories.
I've been taking care of Mo and Joe for over 4 years. I just wanted to give you a funny story. When I first met him, he asked me to take him to an appointment. I never drove his car before. I couldn't fit him in my car, so I had no choice. So I got him in his car, a Toyota hybrid, whatever it was, and I took him to his appointment.
So I
get him to the appointment, take the wheelchair out, put him in, and because of COVID, I couldn't go in. I had to sit in the hallway, on the floor. So he's in there for an hour, they bring him out, and they say, okay, you can take him. I put him in the wheelchair, and I come out, and because I never drove his car before, and I didn't know what his car actually looked like, I went to the wrong car. And he didn't tell me it wasn't his car. So apparently the front door, I unlocked it with his key and the car was open. So I was putting him in the passenger seat and the gentleman was sitting in the back and banging on the window and said, get out of my effing car. And I said, Mo, and he said, what? And I said, we're in the wrong car. Why'd you put me in this car? How do I know which car is your car? And so I get him out of the car and I told the gentleman, I'm sorry. I'm not in the wrong car. So we get him in the wheelchair, back in the wheelchair, and his car is beside the car that I was in, that he was in. So I just want to say, that was my experience of Mo's car. Thank you everybody for coming.
Next we'll have one of Mo's co-workers from the Petro-Canada refinery, Walter, say a few words.
Hope I can get through this. I'll try to make it short. But I was asked because I worked so long with Mo. We've known each other since 1963, I do believe, if my memory serves me right. I remember Mo starting at the refinery, because I had a hand in his initial training. And we started a starting job when we went to that plant. But we both never lasted long in that job, I'll tell you. Obviously, they liked us until they transferred us out into the operating plant. And that's where we spent all our time. Mo, my friend. Excuse me, is a rare find and is impossible to forget. Now, I'm shook up because he's like a brother to me. Thanks to him and his mom, he got the wife and I in the right direction to our first home. We We raised our kids, he raised his. Now, Mo had a fascination for exotic leather boots. I'm sure you can know all the exotic skins that he had on his boots. He even got me to trade my Wellington's in for a Western boot.
Oh.
I can still get them on, but man, I have a hell of a time getting them on.
I think so. It was a wood, wedge.
Now, Mo and I, after our marriages and our early retirements, we kept in touch. Not very often, but every June the 17th, no matter where I was, I would call Mo, wish him well as we aged, and we would both check on each other to ensure we're both doing okay. But the last June 17th, that's when he finally told me he wasn't doing okay. Now, I was asked for a small story from Mo's working days. And I don't know how good my memory will be, but this little story I have, because it sticks out in my mind, is something we did together. And this shows the devilish side of Mo. In the lab down there, they had what they call a little Cushman scooter. Anybody my age would remember what that is. But it's a little three-wheel vehicle with a little box on the back. And that's what we would take to grab samples off the various products from the tankage on the refinery. Now, I can't remember whether the sampler at that time was Alan or Harold, but Mo and I were working today on the same shift, and the sampler's cart was parked out back. He says, "Walt, come on, lift the back end of this." He says, and he's got two quart cans in his hand. I said, "What are you going to do with them, Mo?" He says, "Lift the back of that scooter." We were young then, in our 20s. He puts one can under each axle. And they were just the right height that the wheels looked as if they were on the ground, but they weren't. That high up. So we're standing there, shooting the baloney. We watch the guy come back, hop on the cart, start it, puts it in gear, and gives the gas to it. You know what snow tires sound like when they're squealing in the snow, not going anywhere? That's the way the scooter sounds. Well, Mo and I are just beside ourselves laughing. And of course, it is either Harold or Alan. Like I said, I can't remember which one. They had a few choice words for both Mo and I. But I want to thank, you know him as Mo. I also know him as Easy Money. He knew when I called him Easy Money, I had something important to say to him. And when he called me Walter, I knew he had something to say to me. So, thanks for being my friend. God bless.
Thank you for those kind words there, Walter. And I would say that Mo must have carried a lot of weight at Petro-Canada, a lot of people must have owed him a lot of favors, because somehow every year he would get his son a job at the way station of Petro-Canada. And I would go and see Tyler there, and I'd be like, "Holy cow, how'd you get this job?" But yeah, so somebody must have owed Mr. Rockwell some favors or carried some weight, because to get Tyler that job every year would have been awesome. So, okay, so if we could have Andrea, Mo's neighbor for over 30 years, say a few words.
Yeah, I didn't make notes. as you just introduce me. I moved to Canada 32 years ago as a new bride, still live in the same house. And Mo and Joe have basically been a part of our lives ever since I arrived. So Joe went to all the baby showers, Mo has literally watched all our children grow up. And there are a number of maple buds in this room. So I think we can all attest to the fact that Mo was definitely a fixture on our street. I think most of us will think of him sitting on his chair on the little front porch, occasionally swearing at a car that was bolting down the road. He taught me a few swear words, I can tell you. but I think the thing I want to say, we always joke about his bark was probably worse than his bite, but I got to know Mo that had the biggest heart, and particularly over the last few years, we would sit down and have amazing conversations. You know, we didn't always agree about a lot of things, Kelly. Your speech was so perfect. He loved both his boys fiercely. We talked about both of you, you know, and like any family, there's always tension, but there's always love. And the boys, the grandsons, I'd heard everything, all the things that you guys got to do, and he would show me photographs and tell me about your baseball. And then my doggies, he absolutely loved my dogs. When Rio, the dog that passed away last year, would walk by, he would literally drag me into Mo and Joe's house because Mo had a particular bag of treats waiting for the dogs. So one of the pictures that I've got on there is actually of our new puppy, Badger, who I had to introduce to Mo. Lastly, I think the thing I want to say is, Sheila and Dallas, you were a huge blessing in his life over the last months, years. I think one of the things that we're all so grateful for is that he got to be at home up to the last minute. And I think, you know, for the times that we had to visit him in hospital, which was so hard, it was very hard to see him there. The fact that he was, particularly in the last month, was at home. And I felt in that last month, he was almost more at peace than I'd ever seen him. And there was this feeling of, that he was ready to let go and he was in the place that he wanted to be because he was with you, Joe. And both Cindy's, he was surrounded by all the love in the world. So God bless him. He was one of my best friends here.
Thank you for those kind words, Adrian. So if we could have Jason, his oldest son, come up.
Digital instead of paper. Anyone who knows about my relationship with my dad knows we didn't always agree. It was challenging at times, and we showed love in different ways. But at the end, he's my dad. I love him, but you can't not love your dad. He was strong. He was supportive, he was helpful, he was so protective over his family. Losing my dad it's heartbreaking and so hard to find the right words to express my feelings for him not being here anymore. For the last few years, seeing him suffer like I did was way worse than him leaving. And he had strength like I've never seen strength before. This was one of his fingers. He is a big man. Last time I saw my dad, we were in the hospital, and we've argued quite a bit in our lives. You know, we had difference of opinions and what have you, but this is the last time I got to sit with him and thank him for everything he gave me and who he made me. And we watched old movies and laughed. I love his laugh. It's hard to get him to laugh. You had to have a special trick to get Mo to laugh. You had to fall down. If you fell down, Mo would laugh. That was just his humor. But finally I got to say everything I needed to say. And that was really important. And we really got to like bond, which was something I was so grateful for. And, you know, I thanked him for who he made me, strong and self-sufficient. You know, he gave me a great work ethic. He showed me how to deliver papers when I was 6 years old. So I started going down the streets delivering papers with him at 6 years old, and he'd fold them up, he'd whip them at the doors. And you're like, oh, is that how it's done? He's like, yeah, go. So all of a sudden, I'm carrying bags of papers, and now I'm whipping out the doors. And just kept delivering papers till I was like 14. He always said he was so proud of me when I became a professor at Sheridan College. He's like, I don't know what the hell happened to you. You were so dumb in high school. And I was like, I don't know what happened either, Dad. Things change, I guess. We change as we get older, you know? And he had these amazing, like, sayings. Mike mentioned one earlier, the sun will come up tomorrow. You know, like, he had these go-tos all the time. One of the ones he always said to me is, and I'm taking this forward into health and life, and it's like, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, Jay. Like, he'd always say, just try to prevent what's going to happen instead of doing it. And when he'd see me struggling, using my strength to fix something, or try to fix something, he's like, you're not using your biggest muscle. And I was like, what's my biggest muscle? Like, your brain. Use your brain, Jay. Because he was a thinker. He was a quiet man, he was a thinker. You know, he gave me the coolest last name in the world, Rock Life. You know, you can't get much better than that. He gave me good looks. He gave me the most amazing brother and the most amazing mom anyone could ever ask for. You're the best mom. You're an angel. I love you so much. He would always tell me how much he loves me. And he just had a hard time showing it. But for some reason, we still got through it. Until those last few years, and that was my biggest regret, was that we didn't learn how to share love and communicate earlier in life. We only have so many years in our lives, and we've got to, you know, make them count. And family is all we really have at the beginning and the end. So hold your family close, like, bury the hatchets and, like, find a place of love. It's the biggest lesson I've learned from having my dad as a father and going through everything I did. The other day I was thinking about, what is family? And of course I asked Google for some help. And a bunch of things came up which I thought were really interesting. I grabbed a couple and I'm sharing them with you. Families are like branches on a tree. We grow in different directions, yet we all come from the same roots. You know, family is a risky venture. Because the greater the love, the greater the loss. That's the trade-off, but I'll take it all. That was Brad Pitt. The other night I ate at a really nice restaurant. Every table had an argument going on. George Carlin. Life isn't easy, but it's worth it. And with that said, I'd like to say thanks some people that were really special to me and my family and who helped us out so much. Cindy and Marv, thank you. Mike, Maureen, thank you so much. The army of PSWs. I don't know if any of those here, but we must have had 25 PSWs. My dad wanted to stay in the house as his last wish was he did not want to die in a hospital. So he had special people taking care of him, and you met one of them earlier, Sheila. Thank you for all of your help in Dallas. Like, it's not easy taking care of people in that stage of their life, and my mom did it for a career for 30 some odd years, and I know how the challenges you went through, and I thank you so much for that. And lastly, I'd like to thank my brother. You're a rock, man. Rest in peace, Mo. My dad, my teacher, my greatest blessing. Thank you, and we will all see you soon.
Thank you, Jim. Finally, we have Tyler, his youngest son, come up and say a few words in memories.
I shouldn't.
Hi, everybody. I appreciate y'all coming. Starting heavy today. I've been good up till now, but I want to thank everybody in the room for coming out. That means a lot for my parents, my mom and brother, my kids and wife. My dad, Mo, he was larger than life to me. A jack of all trades type of man, a simple man, a hard-working man. I'm gonna miss his advice and knowledge of everything. His calls on Saturday to help him finish his Toronto Star crossword. And I would say, you know, Dad, if you just learned how to use the internet, you could look up the answer.
That was a good one.
And he quickly quipped back to, he didn't need to look it up because I could do it for him. He loved his Toronto Blue Jays. We would talk at great length about how they could improve, what their thoughts were on trades and the new players, and I'd always get a good kick when he tried to pronounce Latino players with names wrong. I was 12 when he took me to the Jays game in 1985 when they won their first pennant. Just before they clinched the game, he leaned down to me and said, stay close to him, as he knew the sellout crowd would go bananas. And as usual, he was right, and my full-time protector. Our dad was always a good provider and hardworking. His family always came first. My dad and mom were set up on a date way back by mutual friends. And on their second date, my dad took my mom to a restaurant called Sai Wu's Chinese Restaurant in Toronto. After dinner, my mom opened up her fortune cookie and the inscription read, you will marry your present lover. And that was almost 53 years ago. My dad adored his wife, our mom, Jo. They were completely opposite, but somehow they made it work. To my Johnny, always the best. Thanks for being the efficient today. I could always count on it. Both their parents, Mo and Joe, moved around a lot growing up with their respective families. And after their wedding, they decided to start a family of their own. And they settled on a small bungalow house, 327 in the middle of Maple Avenue. To all the neighbors in and around her home, you have become close friends and not just neighbors. I know some of you moved on and some have passed away, but the memories are forever. From the bottom of my heart, I want to thank you all for your kindness towards our parents and keeping an eye on them as they grew older over the years. To Sheila and her family, I want to thank you for signing on probably for more than you ever originally thought. But the last couple years, you have been so helpful, and we will always call you friends. I need a new one. Sorry. It's easy on me. One memory I remember from my dad, I don't remember where the occasion was, but we were at a celebration of some sort with a bunch of my friends, and a few days went by and I went to visit my dad and mom, and I got chatting with Mo, and he said in his own unique way, you know, Tyler, one of the best things that you have done so far in your life is that you have accumulated a wealth of great friends. He knew how important my friends meant to me. And you notice how caring they were toward me. To all my friends, I want to thank you for always being there for me in my times of need like today. To Cindy and Marv and the rest of my American family, you've always been so kind to my dad and mom, always willing to travel back and forth to check in on them, invite them for shopping trips and great get-togethers. I am honored to have you all in my life. To my wife, Kelly, Mo liked you from the beginning. He said that you always had an infectious smile and a boisterous laugh that is contagious. Thank you always for being by my side and being my rock that I need. To my two boys, Helen and Quinn, Granddad loved you more than you will ever know. He was the proudest of proud for all your accomplishments so far in your young lives, and you were apples in his eyes. Dad, I will miss your wisdom, advice, and hearing your voice. I hope to keep making you proud of me. Feel free to come back and visit me once in a while because I'm missing you. You're not in pain anymore and in a better place. Until we meet again on the other side, I hope you have eternal peace and I love you so much. Thank you all for coming today.
So I can say that Mo really loved his family. The last few months I had an opportunity to go and see him in the hospital, and I'd go in and visit him, and you know, his face would light up, and I was just bringing him a Subway sub. Like, you'd think I was giving him a winning lottery ticket or something, but he was just happy to see a familiar face. And I'd go in there and I'd be like, hey Mo, what do you think about those Jays? And all he wanted to talk about is boys. I'm like, but what about those Jays? He just wanted to talk about his boys. And I'm like, oh my God, I talked to Tyler enough. I talked about his family enough. So then, I'd leave, and then next time I'd come in, and again, I'd bring another sub in, and again, lit up, and I'm like, this is the easiest thing ever. And I'd go in there, and I'd be like, how about those Jays? And he just wanted to talk about his family. That's all he wanted to do at the end. Is talk about his family. So he truly loved everybody in his family. Thank you, Tyler. At this time, I would ask that we have a few moments of silence to remember Mo as we listen to one of his favorite songs, Annie by John Denver.
Like a storm in the
We are profoundly glad that Mo lived. We are glad that we saw his face and felt the glow of his friendship and love. We cherish the memory of his words and deeds and character, carrying him thus in our hearts. Let us now proceed from this place in comfort and in peace, assured that every time of even in this time of loss and sorrow, life remains precious and good. May we also on this day rekindle in our hearts an appreciation for the gifts of life in others' persons. Let us honor the life of Mo by living ourselves more nobly and loving in the days ahead. As you return to the routines of your lives, go in love, and may abiding peace go with you. We'll end this gathering in memory of Mo with one of his other favorite songs, My Way by Frank Sinatra. Thank you for coming, everyone. If you would like to join us for the burial at St. Jude Cemetery, it's located just a few blocks west of us on Lakeshore. Once again, on behalf of the Rockliffs, thank you for sharing your memories of Mo and being here for the family today. Mo, you'll be missed. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, for those of you who are processing with us to the cemetery, if you'll just pull your cars to the front of the driveway behind the lead car with the purple light, please make sure that you're stopping for all stoplights and follow traffic safety. We're only a couple blocks away. We won't lose you.